So another important metabolic pathway is the pentose phosphate pathway or exose monophosphate pathway, which is mainly not for the energy formation, but rather for the important biomolecule synthesis. So pentose phosphate pathway is also known as HMP shunt pathway, so where the hexose sugar are shunted to form the pentose sugar and other forms of the hexose sugar at the end of the metabolism. So why it is needed? It is needed because rapidly dividing cells such as bone marrow, skin, intestinal mucosa and tumor, they use pentose ribose 5-phosphate to make RNA, DNA and other coenzymes, and this NADPH, which is produced in this pentose phosphate pathway, is required for number of important biomolecule synthesis like fatty acid synthesis, nucleotide synthesis. You are required for the macrophages for phagocytosis and also for maintaining the reduced state of glutathione for antioxidant activity. So let's go forward. That what are the pathways where which requires NADPH? So fatty acid synthesis, cholesterol synthesis, neurotransmitter synthesis, nucleotide biosynthesis. So these are the pathways requiring NADPH. And then in detoxification, we have reduction of oxidized glutathione, cytochrome P450 monooxygenation. This is mainly required for the antioxidant activity in the body, and for this we require NADPH, and for NADPH we require HMP shunt pathway, because this is the only pathway which gives you NADPH as the metabolite in the whole pathway. So now we have oxidative reactions in the pentose phosphate pathway, and the second part is your isomerization reaction, ultimately forming the NADPH, your other form of the hexose monophosphate or the monosaccharides. So the substrate here is glucose 6-phosphate, that is, which is converted into from glucose by a hexokinase or your glucokinase, which undergoes a dehydrogenation reaction. So here you can see that here this compound, that is the glucose 6-phosphate, undergoes a dehydrogenation reaction to form NADPH, which is giving you 6-phosphogluconolactone. This glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase, that is G6PD, is the rate limiting step in case of your in your HMP shunt pathway, because this is the major contributor which can modulate the whole HMP shunt pathway. Now this 6-phosphogluconolactone is converted by the help of the enzyme gluconolactonase to form 6-phosphogluconate. Here 6-phosphogluconate is formed, which is further going for a dehydrogenation where there is loss of the where there is oxidation happening, forming NADPH, and this NADPH along with the oxidative decarboxylation removing your carbon dioxide forms ribulose 5-phosphate. So this is the pentose sugar which is formed at the first oxidative phase, and this ribulose 5-phosphate by the help of the enzyme epimerase, we all read in our first isomeric slide by what are the epimerase, where the compound they differ within only one carbon, they differ between one carbon, it is known as epimerase, or it can be converted by isomerase to other compound like ribose 5-phosphate. So the first pathway is in the your pentose phosphate pathway is the oxidative reaction, where all the oxidation is happening. Here is one oxidation, which is the rate limiting step, and the second dehydrogenation, here it is happening, forming 2-NADPH here. Now, ribulose 5-phosphate, which was formed previously, it undergoes an epimerization reaction. Epimerase means it can catalyze the reaction which are epimers, which differ in only one carbon compound, forming xylulose 5-phosphate, and it also goes isomerization, forming ribose 5-phosphate. Isomers mean having the same molecular formula but different structural formula. So here is ribulose and ribose, they just have the change in the orientation, while there in ribulose and xylulose the orientation of one carbon is differing. So this ribose 5-phosphate is required for the synthesis of genetic material like DNA and RNA. Now here there is interconversion phase in pentose phosphate pathway. The first was oxidative reaction happening, where we had more amount of dehydrogenation, which which gave us NADPH and carbon dioxide. The second phase is how is this, the product which was formed here was ribulose 5-phosphate, which is a pentose sugar. This ribulose 5-phosphate is interconverted in the second phase by the help of transketolase and transaldolase. It means this transketolase will only act on keto sugar and transaldolase on aldose sugar, forming the subsequent product. Now, xylulose 5-phosphate and ribose 5-phosphate are acted upon by transketolase to form glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is a 3-carbon compound, and cetoheptulose 7-phosphate. So this is a keto sugar and this is an aldose sugar. I've already told glyceraldehyde is an aldose, dihydroxyacetone is the keto sugar. Now, here the aldolase reaction happens between glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and cetoheptulose 7-phosphate to give you ribulose 5-phosphate and erythrose 4-phosphate. So here, this ribulose which is formed in your subsequent reaction, it undergoes by the help of your epimerase, it got xylulose, and this xylulose, sorry, here it is not ribulose, it is xylulose 5-phosphate. Now, this xylulose 5-phosphate with the help of erythrose 4-phosphate, this is again a keto sugar. So, this gives you important compounds of your HNP shunt, that is fructose 6-phosphate and glyceraldehyde, 3-phosphate. Now, this fructose 6-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate can go for glycolysis. What we got here is, there is 6-glucose 6-phosphate which had entered in your HMP shunt pathway. We got 6-carbon compound, we got 6-carbon dioxide liberation. We got 6 molecules of your NADPH and 1 glucose, and we got, again we got 5 hexose monophosphate compound. So 1 glucose is completely oxidized. So this is the major product in your HMP shunt pathway. So it is also known as hexose monophosphate, because at the end you are getting a hexose monophosphate pathway, monophosphate compound. Why it is known as pentose phosphate pathway? Because in between you are getting the 5-carbon sugar like ribose 5-phosphate, ribulose 5-phosphate. This ribose 5-phosphate is important for the synthesis of DNA and RNA, which uses this sugar. Now, the summary of pentose phosphate pathway, we have ribulose 5-phosphate is converted into ribose 5-phosphate by the help of enzyme isomerase. They are the isomers of each other. So they are converted into ribulose 5-phosphate is converted into ribose 5-phosphate by the help of enzyme, that is the isomerase, because these two are the isomers, and the ribulose and xylulose are the epimers which differ in only one carbon. Then you have transketolase, which catalyzes the keto group, keto sugar, that is xylulose 5-phosphate, and transaldolase, which catalyzes the aldose sugar, that is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So this reaction happens subsequently, transketolase, transaldolase, and again transketolase, which catalyzes the compound xylulose 5-phosphate. Now, so 3 ribulose 5-phosphate is giving you glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and 2 fructose 6-phosphate. So, in the summary, you have 6-carbon, that is 6-glucose molecule is completely liberated, that is 1-glucose molecule is completely oxidized, forming 6 your CO2 and your 5-fructose-6-phosphate, which can be converted into glucose-6-phosphate by isomerase, and glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate. These, both of these compounds can go for glycolysis in the further steps, or whenever the body requires glycolysis to happen. Now, why we require HMP shunt pathway? I have shown you that HMP shunt pathway is not for the energy yielding process, but rather it is going for anabolic process like synthesis of your fatty acid via NADPH, your synthesis of your DNA and RNA by pentose sugar. It is also required for the phagocytosis by macrophages. It is also required for the reduced state of glutathione to remain by the help of your NADPH. So the two important biomolecule which is formed is your pentoses and NADPH. NADPH is required for reductive biosynthesis of fatty acid, cholesterol synthesis, and steroid hormone synthesis, and also in case of detoxification. Detoxification as in by genobiotics and also by macrophages for phagocytosis. So pentose for DNA and RNA, sugar, and NADPH for your fatty acid synthesis, reductive biosynthesis of cholesterol and other and fatty acid metabolism. Antioxidant role. Antioxidant role is mainly for maintaining the reductive state of glutathione. So it maintains glutathione in reduced state. So if the glutathione is not in the reduced state, if there is any production of reductive oxygen species, your glutathione will not be able to convert that reductive oxygen species to less harmful and liberate in the form of water. So here you can see here, so NADPH, if it is present in our body, which is produced from your HMP shunt, so an HMP shunt is giving you NADPH, with the help of enzyme glutathione reductase, it itself get reduced to NADP+. But this oxidized, this GSHG is the oxidized form of glutathione, is remaining or maintained to glutathione, reduced glutathione by the help of NADPH. Once when there is body is exposed to your free radicals or your there is lipid peroxidation, this glutathione takes all of these molecules and it itself gets oxidized. While this compound are converted into less toxic form, or it is liberated or converted into water, but it itself get oxidized. But this oxidized glutathione has to be converted into the reduced glutathione by the presence of NADPH. If there is no NADPH, glutathione cannot move into its reduced form. Phagocytosis. This is mainly taken by the macrophages. The macrophages make use of NADPH for taking up the bacteria or any foreign material to engulf those material and render it non-toxic. And if there is no NADPH, phagocytosis is not effective, or it cannot be undertaken by your macrophages. And metabolism of genobiotics for detoxification, as like same of this, is done in the presence of NADPH. Special function in erythrocyte. Erythrocytes can also erythrocyte integrity is maintained by your NADPH, and NADPH also maintains your NADPH is also required for your phagocytosis. And if the NADPH is not present or it is absent, like your if there is deficiency of NADPH because of the deficiency in HMP shunt pathway, like the first enzyme glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase, RBC cannot maintain its integrity, and that's why there is more and more aggregated your sulfahydryl group, which can cause degradation of RBC, leading to hemolytic anemia. So how is this HMP shunt regulated? I have told you the HMP shunt pathway is regulated. The first one is entry of glucose 6 phosphate. Glucose 6 phosphate is the precursor of your is the one of the substrate to initiate the HMP shunt, and is mainly by the cellular concentration of NADPH. If NADPH is low, this glucose 6 phosphate is going for more and more amount of HMP shunt. Now, glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase, if it is it is inhibited by your NADPH. If more and more NADPH is produced, it can strongly inhibit glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase, so that less HMP shunt pathway is taken place. Now, I have told you that there is a importance of G6PD in special function in erythrocyte for maintaining its integrity, so that it can tackle with the macrophages and it can tackle with the free radical which can free radical in which is exposed. So this is mainly done by glucose 6 NADPH, and if there is deficiency of glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase, this can lead to different clinical condition. Generally, this is asymptomatic, that is patient is not symptomatic until and unless they are exposed to drugs like your anti-malarial drug, like primaquine anti-malarial drug, or drugs like which contains sulfate, that is sulfur drugs, faba beans, which is giving more amount of the oxidized particle, or it is giving it undergoes more amount of the oxidation, which is giving more amount of your oxygen free radical to the RBC. So whenever these patients who have deficiency of G6PD, they are exposed to these compounds, they can have features of hemolytic anemia, that is, they have the features of anemia, and because of the more amount of the heme degradation, that can lead to increase in bilirubin. So as such, these G6PD deficiency patients are asymptomatic, but they are, if they are exposed to such conditions, they can have the symptoms of your symptoms of anemia, that is, they have jaundice because of the deficiency of G6PD. Now, it is an X-linked inherited disorder, and this causes the impairment of the synthesis of NADPH in RBC. It causes accumulation of methemoglobin because there is more and more amount of your SH group production if those compounds are formed, and peroxidized in erythrocytes, which causes hemolysis. That's why there is hemolytic anemia. It is asymptomatic, but whenever they are exposed to these drugs, that can lead to flaring, or that can lead to hemolysis in these patients who have G6PD deficiency. Now, how will we know whether they are having G6PD deficiency or not? That is mainly by the exact measurement of enzyme, that is glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase in the blood, by spectrophotometric analysis of G6PD at the rate of NADPH production from NADP. So this is the method by which we can diagnose the enzyme activity. So we can measure the enzyme G6PD in the blood of these patients. And what happens in these patients, a characteristic feature of hind bodies are seen in the peripheral smears. These hind bodies are nothing but they are aggregated sulfur disulfide containing compounds which are aggregated inside the RBCs, and that gives the appearance of your, there is mainly anisocoagulocytosis in the patients with your G6PD deficiency, which gives the typical appearance, and it is also known as the Hinge bodies. Now, I have given a clinical scenario where a patient, he just prior to plan departure to the tropical place like your Africa or a tropical climate region, a patient visited his physician, and what he noted was there was weakness and his urine had recently became unexplainably dark. On physical examination, he was found to be ecteric, and he had a very low hematocrit and high reticulocyte count, and there was significant amount of increased bilirubin. What was his past history suggestive of was he had a previous visit a month earlier where he received immunization and prescription for anti-malarial drug. So because of this anti-malarial drug, it can be chloroquine, primaquine, this can have precipitated G6PD deficiency, so the patient might be already G6PD deficient, but he was asymptomatic until unless he was exposed to the condition like your anti-malarial drug or sulfa drugs, or like your, if he has consumed faba beans, that can precipitate the condition and gives the clinical feature of jaundice, in decrease in hematocrit, decrease in hemoglobin, and high reticulocyte count.